The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Hear us, O Lord, for your mercy is great. We will exalt you, O God, our Savior, and praise your name forever and ever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Christ, our Passover. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. So let us celebrate the feast, not with the old leaven of corruption and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Christ, once raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. In dying, he died to sin once for all. In living, he lives to God. See yourselves, therefore, as dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who sleep. For as by man came death, by man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free from the bondage of our sins and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Psalm 31. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. You hate those who pay regard to worthless idols, but I trust in the Lord. I will exalt and rejoice in your steadfast love because you have seen my affliction. You have taken heed of my adversities and have not delivered me into the hand of the enemy. You have set my feet in a broad place. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eye wastes away from grief, my soul and body also, for my life is spent with sorrow and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my misery, and my bones waste away. I am the scorn of all my adversaries, a horror to my neighbors, an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the street flee from me. I have passed out of mind like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel, for I hear the whispering of many, terror all around me, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. Do not let me be put to shame, O Lord, for I call on you. Let the wicked be put to shame. Let them go dumbfounded to Sheol. Let the lying lips be still that speak insolently against the righteous with pride and contempt. Oh, how abundant is your goodness that you have laid up for those who fear you. and accomplished for those who take refuge in you. In the sight of everyone, in the shelter of your presence, you hide them from human plots. You hold them safe under your shelter from contentious towns. Blessed be the Lord, for he has wondrously shown his steadfast love to me when I was beset as a city on the siege. I had said in my alarm, I am driven far from your sight. But you heard my supplications when I cried out to you for help. Love the Lord, all you his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts haughtily. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 24, beginning at verse 1 through verse 10. The Lord showed me two baskets of figs placed before the temple of the Lord. This was after King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon had taken into exile from Jerusalem King Jeconiah, son of Jehoiakim of Judah, together with the officials of Judah, the artisans, and the smiths, and had brought them to Babylon. One basket had very good figs, like first ripe figs, but the other basket had very bad figs, so bad that they could not be eaten. And the Lord said to me, "What do you see, Jeremiah?" I said, "Figs. The good figs, very good, and the bad figs, very bad, so bad that they cannot be eaten." Then the word of the Lord came to me. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, "Like those good figs, so I will regard as good the exiles from Judah, whom I have sent away from this place to the land of the Chaldeans. I will set my eyes upon them for good, and I will bring them back to this land. I will build them up and not tear them down. I will plant them and not pluck them up. I will give them a heart to know that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. For they shall return to me with their whole heart." But thus saith the Lord, "Like the bad figs, that are so bad they cannot be eaten, so I will treat King Zedekiah of Judah, his officials, the remnant of Jerusalem who remain in this land, and those who live in the land of Egypt. I will make them a horror, an evil thing, to all the kingdoms of the earth, a disgrace, a byword, a taunt, and a curse in all the places where I shall drive them. And I will send sword, famine, and pestilence upon them, until they are utterly destroyed from the land that I gave to them and their ancestors." Word of the Lord. A Song to the Lamb. Splendor and honor and kingly power are yours by right, O Lord our God. For you created everything that is, and by your will they were created and have their being. And yours by right, O Lamb that was slain. For with your blood you have redeemed for God from every family, language, people, and nation a kingdom of priests to serve our God. And so to him who sits upon the throne, and to Christ the Lamb, be worship and praise, dominion and splendor, forever and forevermore. A reading from the book of John, chapter 9, beginning at verse 1
through verse 17.
As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it's day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see.
The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I don't know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet."
The word of the Lord.
The Y Factor. God, man, and human suffering. Why do humans suffer? What does God have to say about that? Let us pray. Father, open our eyes that we might see you in the revelation of your word and seeing be changed from glory to glory. In Jesus' name, amen. As Jesus' disciples walked, they encountered a blind man begging in the streets. The fact that this man was blind from birth seems to be a well-known fact. What was not known, however, was why. Why was he blind from birth? So the disciples asked Jesus the answer to what I consider an age-old question, the question of human suffering. Looking at it theologically, they asked Jesus, who caused this man to sin? Would it be his own sin? Would it be his parents' sin? And in this question, we see that everything, it seems, must have a cause. We believe in cause and effect. And so, why is suffering a factor in life is the question based on this idea of cause and effect. What is the cause? So when we think of God and how good and how just he is, and when we think of that, we are forced to ask, how could a good and just God allow humans to suffer? If indeed God is good and just, then we must be the ones at fault. And the person suffering must have done something wrong, or at least they must be suffering from some ancestral sin. What makes this question more complex is the fact that many evil people seem to be thriving, while good people seem to suffer. And if God is just and holy and good, how could he allow that? With this idea of cause and effect, that has to be a question on the minds of everyone. And so Jesus was asked to respond to this issue of human suffering by his disciples. And I liked Jesus' response. Jesus' response was salvific. Jesus' answer was not an exercise in philosophical and theological gymnastics. His answer was an answer that solved problems. To answer the question as they asked it would be a fruitless exercise. Now, what if it were true? What if it was the man's fault that he was blind? What if it was his parents' fault that he was blind? What does that solve? What does that answer solve? The most it might do is give those who are not suffering in the moment a feeling of superiority. Well, you know, we're not suffering because we're good. We're sinless. And which, of course, we know is preposterous. So Jesus' answer would be the kind of answer that we will need to hear even today. And I'm hoping that we can hear from Jesus' answer how we might best live quality lives in the midst of the chaos that life presents us. So let's explore Jesus' answer and discover the good news about salvation in the face of suffering. So first of all, Jesus' answer offered a new perspective. He says, neither this man nor his parents sin that he was born blind. He was born blind, listen to this, that the works of God might be revealed in him. Jesus reframed the circumstance in the context of who God is and what God really is about. It doesn't matter who sinned at this point. What matters is what would God do about it? And so Jesus showed his disciples a completely different view of the situation as God saw it. The disciples' question was a binary question, either this or that. and it all led to something negative. Jesus gave them a third possibility, the true reason. Jesus said, neither this man nor his parents sin. He was born blind so that the works of God might be revealed in him. Verse 3. Jesus informs us that we must choose to see beyond our circumstances as they present themselves and to recognize their true nature. We must reframe our circumstances in accordance with God's reality and not how we look at it with our natural eyes. With a renewed perspective, we are able to see both ourselves and our circumstances in a new light. Someone said, things can either happen to you or for you. Your perspective can make the difference. Your perspective can tell the difference. And so, our perspective is that which is important, Jesus is saying. How we see the circumstance and not how we think about it on the natural plane, but how we see it in through his eyes. For those of us who can see past the natural and into the spiritual, we understand this. We say, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to them who are called according to his purpose, Romans 8:28. For those of us who can see through the spiritual eye and not the natural eye, we will say, all things work together for good and that God is in everything. Everyone else is simply a blind beggar reacting to circumstances without any spiritual guidance whatsoever. No one else has a guarantee. This is not saying everything is good, like people say. Everything it works out for good. No, everything is not good only to those who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. A new perspective. God is at work in all our circumstances, trying to bring us into insight into who he is, who we are, and what he wants us to do. Secondly, God brings a new personality into the mix. He says, I am the light of the world. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. John chapter 9, verse 5. Jesus here revealed that he was the source of insight. He said, I am the light of the world. So when we speak of a change of perspective, we're not just talking about a positive mental attitude or the law of attraction or some such self-help advice. What we're talking about here is Christ bringing the meaning to the reality. This is not about closing our eyes and saying, looking at the garden full of weeds and saying, there are no weeds, there are no weeds. This is about facing the reality and having some integrity, understanding that we have sight that is beyond the natural. Jesus is saying, I am the light of the world. I am the source of enlightenment. Jesus decided to help this blind man as a sign of this truth, of this fact. So Jesus was revealing here that he is the source of light, the only true perspective in life, the only true insight we may have. Neither the Pharisees, nor the people, nor not even this man himself could help himself. There was nothing he can do to change his circumstance. He was stuck unless something from the outside could bring a change. And the only person that everyone knew could bring that change was God. And so Jesus says, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. The world with its new age spirituality offers us enlightenment apart from God. They depersonalize God and reemphasize human abilities. Believe in yourself, they say. You are your own God. Look to the God within, and so on. We are in internal darkness, and we are asked to accept this darkness as normal. We are asked even to accept this darkness as light. Humanity as a whole has been trying to direct their own life since Eden, and we've made a mess of it. Oh, what a mess we have made. But Jesus is saying, I am the light of the world. I am come to bring the difference. I am your source of deep self-understanding. I am your clear insight into reality. I am the true meaning of life. Every human being is in me. I am in every human being. See me, believe in me, and you will understand more about who you are, who God is, and who God is. Finally, Jesus not only brought a new perspective and a new personality, but he brought a new purpose. He says, I must work the works of him who sent me while it's day. Jesus revealed that the work that he's called to do is a work that he's commissioned to do. And the work that he's called and commissioned to do was, he was called and commissioned by God. This is not his own task. So he's doing the work that he was sent by God to do. He says, I must do the work of him who sent me. He is a sent man. The work that Jesus was sent to do was the work of bringing enlightenment to us. We are blinded by sin and we do not understand the true realities of the universe. We keep searching for meaning in life and we keep searching for understanding as to why these horrors exist. Jesus is saying, I can bring new meaning to that circumstance. Jesus was commissioned by God the Father to bring this light and to set off a chain reaction that when the spark that he lit in the hearts and minds of his disciples would continue throughout the church. I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I am the light of the world. In him there is light and there is no darkness at all. The darkness cannot overcome it, he says. And so Jesus demonstrated this in this sign of healing the blind man. Jesus took his spittle and mixed it in mud, daubed it on the blind man's eyes, and sent him to a pool called Sent. So this man is commissioned by Jesus to receive his sight. And so this blind man, if he chose to believe Jesus, he must enlist the help of others to get him to the pool called Sent. He must enlist others in the quest. On this journey, he must ask for directions, and for those who are curious enough to ask, he must tell his story. And some may choose to believe in him and help him, and some may choose to dismiss him, some may choose to ignore him, but some may choose to dismiss him. But my friends, they will hear the message nevertheless. And the one who chose to help him will be the one who will be able to embrace the miracle firsthand and witness it. And then, of course, they will have to choose to believe what they will do with that message. This blind man was on a mission. Even before he got his sight, his physical sight, he was able to acquire spiritual insight that comes from faith. Such is the nature of our own mission, my friends. We, the church, are the body of Christ. Christ is the head, and we are the continuing presence of Christ on earth. And so we, in our search for light, in our growth, in our development, we let people know that that's the journey we're on. We're not perfect, but as we explore and explain and tell our story, the story of Jesus Christ and what he did for us and what he's going to do for us, hopefully someone will listen to us and hear us and follow. And that's why I am on this very journey, making this very message. So, brothers and sisters, what about you? Are you on this journey? From the time this man decided to go on the journey, his insight began. So, Jesus presented us with a new perspective on circumstances, a new person to look to for answers, and a new purpose in life. Jesus said that his mission, and by extension our own mission, is time sensitive. I must work the works of him who sent me while it's day. Day means an opportunity to seize the day, an opportunity to grab at getting this enlightenment, this truth. Because when night comes, there is no light, there is no enlightenment. So our message is time sensitive. Jesus knew he was leaving, and he was going to leave us with the task. And one day we too will leave. He's going to take his church out of the world, and then there's going to be utter darkness. Meanwhile, our mission is to go out spreading the word of light. That is what the truth is. In the midst of suffering, in the midst of pain, we help people to see it and approach it much differently. Shall we pray? Father, grant us sight beyond sight, that we may be able to see ourselves reflected in you through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, to live out our purpose, revealing the truth of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy. Show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall never hope in vain. The Collect. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in your safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity, and in all we do, direct us to fulfilling of your purpose, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Prayer of Dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let's bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.